Please stand, turning to face the cross of Christ. As we remember the birth of our nation this morning, let us offer our thanks and prayers to God for the women and men who braved the long journey by sea to come to this new world. We thank you, Lord.
For the tribes and nations who inhabited this land for generation upon generation.
We thank you, Lord. For patriots who dreamed of and fought for a free nation.
We thank you, Lord. For the men and women who laid the foundation of our democracy and who pledged liberty and justice for all.
We thank you, Lord. For those who built this country brick by brick, road by road, and town by town.
We thank you, Lord. For the brave soldiers who have fought for our country, for all who paid for our freedom by their service and sacrifice.
We thank you, Lord, for the innovators and artists, poets and teachers, farmers and factory workers, for all who labor and provide for the common good. We thank you, Lord.
For this land with its peaks and valleys, coast and deserts, fields and meadows.
We thank you, Lord, for our own community, for those who came before us in this place, and for our neighbors near and far.
We thank you, Lord. Gracious God, Father of all nations, bless and defend us and our land. Prosper the work of our hands and increase in us your grace and compassion that we might always be a nation which defends and promotes liberty and freedom, truth and justice for all. Amen.
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have given us this good land as our heritage. As we gather in worship, fill our hearts with thanksgiving and our mouths with praise. Bless our country with honesty, truth, and honor. Save us from violence and discord, from pride and arrogance. When times are prosperous, keep us humble. In times of trouble, do not let our trust in you fail. Through it all, may we commend our lives to you for the common good. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
While revolutionary danger was gathering around New York and its inhabitants were in mute suspense and fearful anticipation, the General Congress at Philadelphia was discussing with closed doors what John Adams pronounced, the greatest question ever doubted in America, and as great as ever was or will be debated among men. The result was a resolution passed in a unanimous vote on the 2nd of July that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states. The 2nd of July, Adams continued, will be the most memorable epoch in the history of America. I am apt to believe that it will be celebrated by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival. Oh, it ought to be commemorated as the day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to Almighty God. It ought to be solemnized with pomp and parade, with shows, games, sports, guns, bells, bonfires, and illuminations from one end of this continent to the other, from this time forth evermore. The event has indeed given rise to an annual jubilee, but not on the day designated by Adams. The 4th of July is the day of national rejoicing, for on that day, the Declaration of Independence was adopted. Thomas Jefferson responded, "The God who gave us life, gave us liberty." Tradition gives a dramatic effect to its announcement. It was known to be under discussion, but the closed doors of Congress excluded the populace. They awaited in throngs an appointed signal. In the steeple of the State House was a bell imported 23 years previously from London by the provincial Liberty throughout all the land, unto all the inhabitants thereof. A joyous peal from that bell gave notice that a Declaration of Independence had been passed. It was a new country for us all.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Having served in the military, this is the greatest day for us to share. We can smile. But our first reading is from Deuteronomy 10, 12 to 13, and then 17 to 21. So now, O Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? Only to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments of the Lord your God and his decrees that I am commanding you today for your own well-being. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who is not partial and takes no bribe, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. You shall fear the Lord your God. Him alone you shall worship. To him you shall hold fast, and by his name you shall swear. He is your praise. He is your God who has done for you these great and awesome things that your own eyes have seen. The word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Second reading is the beginning of Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. The word of God, the word of life. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading this morning is from the fifth chapter of St. Matthew. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy,' but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Before I get started this morning, I want to send congregational sympathy to the family of Bud Graber, whose wife, Nan Graber, died yesterday morning. Nan and Bud have been longtime members of this congregation. I might be making a mistake in saying I believe they were married 69 years, but then dated 7 years prior to that. So they knew each other for quite a good long time, I do believe. But it appears as though Nan's funeral service will be perhaps next Friday, but we'll let you know a little bit later on. And also to family of Diane Everhart, and of course that includes so many others in this family whose grandson Hunter died the other day. Hunter has been on our prayer list for a good long time, 2.5 years, 27 years old, died of cancer. So we extend our sympathy to Diane, her family, to all those who are affected by his loss. Let's pray. Lord God, as we gather together in your name, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts might be acceptable in your sight, so that here in this place we might know you more clearly, see you more clearly, and follow you more dearly. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so what you think about 4th of July? I love the 4th of July holiday, I have to admit. I don't know why necessarily. I mean, it's one of my favorite holidays. Takes me back to my childhood when I loved the parades, picnics at the lake, fireworks over the lake. Krista and I never miss the 4th of July concert on the Capitol Mall on PBS. Thoroughly enjoy it. I love the marching bands, all the patriotic songs. I can totally geek out on Star Spangled Banner and listening to Kate Smith singing God Bless America and anything by John Philip Sousa. It's a good day, don't you think, to celebrate our land and to celebrate its freedoms. And it's significant, truly. Significant that we honor the 4th of July in worship. Now, I know that some would disagree, especially after a week like we've had. A lot of folks today are bitter, they're angry, frustrated, which to me, however, is all the more reason why today we intentionally pause. We gather together to give thanks for what is good, to pledge to correct what is wrong, and pray that God will accompany us into the future. Throughout the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln was desperately trying to keep the country united. Soon after the Battle of Antietam, which, as you might remember, is when Americans lost more lives than on any other single day in our history, someone asked the president, "So, whose side is God on, the North or the South?" And Lincoln's response was classic, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My concern, my greater concern, is to be on God's side." President Lincoln, you might know, was begging us to embrace a posture of humility, remembering that the teachings of Jesus call us beyond our tribes, beyond our parties, beyond even our borders, to be partners in helping God bring healing to all of the world. I believe it starts with this word, remember. The most outstanding leaders throughout history have encouraged us to remember that from which we came. John Adams said, "This day must be remembered as our day of deliverance, with shows, with games, sports, bells, bonfires, prayers from one end of this continent to the other, from this time forward and forevermore." Even Irma Bombeck, who remembers Irma Bombeck, right? I mean, you're totally showing your age, right? Irma Bombeck even said this, hey, let's always remember our birth, but not with guns and tanks, instead with family picnics where kids throw frisbees, the potato salad gets iffy, and the flies die from happiness. You may think that you have overeaten, but friends, that's just patriotism. Every society needs a day to remember, a day to collectively gather together and remember the stories that make this day significant. Even Moses said to his people after escaping slavery in Egypt, remember. Remember this day on which you came out of Egypt. Remember and never forget. So today we remember. That's chiefly what we do. We remember the hopefulness of Washington, the brilliance of Jefferson, the courage of Frederick Douglass, the persistence of Susan B. Anthony. Remember the shoeless soldiers of Valley Forge, the blood-soaked fields of Gettysburg, those who died at Normandy, those who survived the fields of Vietnam. Remember the natives who long honored this land and the early settlers who struggled to survive it. Immigrants who arrived with nothing, refugees who just needed another chance. Remember the pilgrim, the native, the slave, the settler, the explorer. Remarkable women and men like Benjamin Franklin, Rosa Parks, Eli Whitney, Betsy Ross, MLK, FDR, Lincoln, Jackie Robinson, Henry Ford, John Muir, Walt Disney, Helen Keller, Maya Angelou, Steinbeck, Faulkner, Thoreau, Sandra Day, Edgar Allan, Ralph Waldo. Look, listen, just tell me this. If you're not sure there's something to celebrate in this country, then I'm not sure what history book you're reading, because it's a remarkable land filled with remarkable people, and I'm forever grateful to be a part of this country. But please, when we remember, we are also called to remember our mistakes, and we've certainly had our share. The inhumanity of slavery, the treatment of the Native American. As we have learned, our systems have at times been corrupt. Our leaders have at times been terribly immoral. But in this country, there has always been a remnant of good people who are trying to be better, citizens who fight for what is right. Why? Because they love this land. From amber waves of grain to purple mountains' majesty, from the Grand Tetons to Mount Mitchell, the Outer Banks to the Shenandoah Valley, the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, the prairies to the Keys, the Piedmont to the canyons, this is an amazing land. Our first reading today is from Deuteronomy chapter 10. It's quite a remarkable reading. It's not written specifically for the 4th of July, of course, but I think we draw from it some remarkable inspiration that is useful and instructive for you and for me, especially on days like today. Here's the setting, Deuteronomy chapter 10. Deuteronomy, by the way, is the fifth book of the Bible. It's for the most part a series of three sermons that Moses has prepared for the people of Israel as they're preparing to enter into the promised land. So when Moses, as you might remember, led the people out of slavery in Egypt, they found themselves in a desert, the wilderness, where they would remain for 40 years, even though the promised land was pretty much just right around the corner, a land that God said was flowing with milk and honey, a remarkable land. There they would find freedom. There they would find abundance. It's a gift, first and foremost, a gift from God, and God promised to walk alongside them every single step of the way. But God also asked for their obedience, a lesson it took 40 years to learn. But now they were ready to step into the promised land. Hallelujah. There was so much excitement, so much joy, so much anticipation. So Moses took the time to put things into perspective. And that's where our first reading takes up today from the 10th chapter of Deuteronomy. Moses says this, before you is a great gift of God. So now, O Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? To fear him and to walk in his ways, to love him, to serve him with all your heart and with all of your soul, and to keep his commandments. And then these beautiful words, for the Lord your God is mighty and awesome, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the stranger, providing them food and clothing. Therefore, you shall also love the stranger, for don't forget that you once were strangers in the land of Egypt. You shall fear him. You shall serve him. You shall hold him fast, for he is your praise. He is your God who has done for you these great and awesome things that your own eyes have seen. It was a pep talk, really. I mean, it was sort of a valedictory address to a certain extent, and soon thereafter, they would, indeed, they'd step right into the promised land. In a nutshell, here's what Moses is saying to them and to us. God has given you freedom, opportunity, abundance, all gifts from God. Now you are called to offer this in return. Number one, remember the goodness of God. Number two, love the stranger, remembering that you once were a stranger. Three, lead by serving. And four, begin each day in praise and thanksgiving. Remember, love, serve, and give thanks. Say that with me. Remember, love, serve, and give thanks. Social media nightly talk shows have led us to severely critique this country and one another, to demonize the other. It's a dark path, don't you think? I much prefer the path of Moses that calls us to remember the goodness of God, to love the stranger, to lead by serving, and to begin each and every day in praise and thanksgiving. Our freedom, after all, comes with great, great responsibility to keep working hard at becoming a more perfect union. Frederick Douglass was a reformer, an abolitionist, statesman, writer, the most influential African-American in the 19th century. Douglass began his life, however, as a slave in Maryland, but he escaped courageously, remarkably, at the age of 21, escaped to New York City. That's when he became, eventually, a leader of the abolitionist movement. He would speak around the country as one of our most famous orators. Well, on July 5th, 1852, now this is 9 years before the Civil War would break out, Douglass offered his most enduring speech, and it's titled this, "What to the Slave is the 4th of July." In it, he demanded freedom and equal rights for slaves, saying that until there is freedom, this 4th of July is yours, but it is not mine. Douglass ends by saying that freedom is never easy. It's a struggle, but, quote, if there is no struggle, there is no progress, for it's in the struggle that we dare to move forward. And it's moving forward, don't you think? It's moving forward that matters most, which is part of the DNA of this country, as it turns out, to move forward. Oliver Wendell Holmes, who would become a Supreme Court justice, wrote this, "Greatness is not where we stood or where we stand, but in what direction we are moving. We must sail sometimes with the wind and sometimes against it, but sail we must and not drift nor lie at anchor." As I said, when Moses offered this particular sermon, Deuteronomy chapter 10, our first reading today, when Moses offered that sermon, the people of Israel, they were preparing to enter the promised land, remember? Their future, bright, filled with expectation, brimming with pride, all of that. But here's the irony. The story was an oral sort of story that the people of Israel passed down from generation to generation in oral form. But that story wasn't actually written down until 400 years later, just after, now catch this, just after that same promised land had literally been destroyed, wiped out by a neighboring empire, the Assyrians. Suddenly, these Israelites, they now were homeless, they were desperate, they were afraid, they were asking, oh, what now? What do we do now? That's when the written form of this story of Moses first appeared. When the people of God, the people of Israel, were defeated, they were penniless, they were terribly afraid. Half of them had been taken into slavery. What that means then, and I think this is remarkable, quite honestly, what that means is that this story of Moses motivated the people of Israel not only when they were filled with joy and expectation, but also when they were loaded with doubt and fear and defeat. Isn't that amazing? I mean, in our best, but also in our worst days, Moses said, in our highs, but also in our lows, we are called to the same mantra, to remember, to love, to serve, and to give thanks. 6 months after the Declaration of Independence was signed. The American colonies were in year two of a bitter, bitter war. It was Christmas Day, 1776, and things looked bleak. A series of defeats had driven the Americans to retreat from New York and New Jersey back across the Delaware River into Pennsylvania. I'm sure you remember this history. Their resources were slim. They were tired. Many of them were shoeless. They were desperate. Morale was low. It looked like all was lost, that this was the end, not just for these men, but for the country. General Washington knew that time was of the essence, and against all conventional wisdom, he waged a gamble that would be the turning point of the war. That afternoon, Washington ordered all of his men to get as many boats as they could possibly find and get them ready to cross the river that night, the essentially frozen river that night. It was cold, the river was swollen with ice and just bitterness, so the crossing was terribly dangerous. But Washington knew that they literally had no other choice. Crossing with him that night, however, would be some pretty remarkable folks later on in the history of America. There were two future presidents of the United States on board. There was a future Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, famous rivals Aaron Burr and Alexander Hamilton. Remarkably, they and all of the 2,500 men made it to the other side, and they were uninjured, even though most were without shoes. When they arrived, Washington quickly marched his men south, attacked at Trenton, New Jersey, totally catching them all by surprise, probably because Washington knew that they'd be hungover from their Christmas celebrations the day before. It was a risk, but Washington's gamble paid off and proved to be the turning point in the war, maybe even the turning point in the history of freedom. The result, well, as news of that victory spread, it renewed the confidence of many patriots that indeed they could and they would defeat the British. But here's part of the story that I love. As it's told, Major James Wilkinson and his troops were south of Trenton on Christmas Day. They likewise, like everybody, tired, depressed. They were just ready to give up. It had already been too long. But they caught wind of Washington's move, and so they too got an extra ounce of courage and began to make their way north. Wilkinson was having a hard time finding his way because of a terrible snowstorm, but he later wrote in his journal these words: "Suddenly, we found our way because the snow on the ground was tinged here and there with blood from the feet of Washington's men, those who wore broken shoes." Don't miss the point. He found his way because of patriot blood, because of the passion, the courage, the bravery of men he did not even know. Men who fought for liberty and freedom for all, not just for a few, but for all. Without their courage, you and I would not be sitting here today, or at the lake, or at the beach, or wherever we are today. We wouldn't be around. Without their sacrifice, the world, no doubt, would be a completely different place. Look, friends, we have much to be thankful for, but we also have much to work on. It's so very, very true. So let's pledge to do both. But let's do so with great humility. Let's do so likewise with great courage and determination. But let's do so likewise with great love in our hearts for God and for the other. A determination to be our better selves for the sake of this country, for the sake of our neighbor, and for the sake of the world. Amen.
Thank you.
Gathered as God's people across time and space, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Holy and loving God, you gather us together this morning through your love and grace. We worship you, for you alone are worthy of our worship, and we offer thanks to you for your presence with us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Creator God, your world abounds with flowing waters and diverse creatures. Guide the work of climate scientists as they develop and advocate ways to restore Earth's natural balance. Motivate all people to adopt lifestyles that protect and sustain the Earth. Lord, in your mercy. Righteous God, make us who came from many nations with many languages a united people who delight in our many gifts. Defend our liberties and give those whom we have entrusted with authority the spirit of wisdom, that there might be justice and peace in our land. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate God, you desire life for all people. As we celebrate Independence Day, instill in us gratitude, generosity, and persistence that we will join you as together we work toward freedom for all people. Lord, in your mercy. Mothering God, you care for all in need. Feed those who are hungry. Heal those who are sick or recovering from surgery, and comfort all who are dying or grieving. We pray your peace for all people. Lord, in your mercy. Comforter God, you promise that weeping may come with the night, but joy comes in the morning. We thank you for our loved ones who have died in faith, especially Nan Graber and Hunter Everhart, and others we name before you. We also pause to remember those who died trapped in a truck at the U.S.-Mexican border. In the fullness of time, gather us around your table of great joy. Lord, in your mercy. As we set our sights toward your table of grace, O Lord, we give you thanks for setting before us this feast of abundance. Through this sacrament, fill us with your love and mercy, for without you, we are nothing. Into your hands, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to receive Holy Communion, we make peace with our sisters and brothers and siblings in Christ using the words, "Peace be with you." Let us share the peace with one another.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks and praise to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and gave it for his disciples to eat. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink by saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Drink from it, all of you, to remember me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food. The body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. Come, for the table is ready.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bless you and strengthen you. Amen. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord make his countenance shine upon you and give you peace. Amen.
To make men holy, let us die to make men free, while God is marching on.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us in worship today, either online or in person. We hope that your 4th of July will be a great celebration and a wonderful opportunity for us to remember the goodness of God, to love the stranger, to serve those in need, right? And to every single day give praise and thanks for the goodness of life. So thank you for being with us today. Now may we go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.